Now, my study is entitled Endurance of a Butterfly. And it's interesting what a butterfly does and can do. I've learned so much about the butterfly since I was studying here, and also a lot more over the weekend. But this is about the butterfly's migration. The monarch butterfly has a migration, and it says, monarchs are considered the long-distance champions of butterfly migration, travelling as many as 4,000 miles round trip. I thought that was amazing, because you always hear of these stories, the migration of the birds doing long distances, but to think of a little butterfly doing similar kind of distances. They begin their flight before the autumn cold sets in, heading south from Canada and the northern United States. Monarchs migrate to the warmer climates of California, Florida, and Mexico, making the trip in 2 months or less and feeding on nectar along the way. Once arriving at their southern destination, they will spend the winter resting for the return flight. Now, I just thought that was such a long distance, and they cover it in 2 months, and they get from where they're going to where they're going, and they don't give up. They all get there. They all have a purpose that God has put in them. He's given them instincts to follow God's plan for their life. They continually fly every day, and I worked out it's about 50 kilometers a day average. That's how many kilometers they're doing, and it's quite a bit to keep up for 2 months. And we can learn some interesting lessons just from this lesson from the butterfly, just from what it does here. Something to do with the Christian journey, the Christian walk. The Christian journey is actually compared to something. In 1 Timothy 4, verses 5 to 8, says something about the Christian journey. Sorry, I just have to get my Bible. First Timothy chapter 4, verses 5 to 8. And it says, but watch thou in all things. Sorry, it might be 2 Timothy. Sorry, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 5 to 8. It says, but watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. So Paul gets to the end of his journey, his Christian journey, and he says, I have fought a good fight. So, is the Christian journey not just a migration? It says it's a fight. Paul called it a fight. So therefore, I've called the Christian journey something else. It's a war. It's a war that we're fighting. So our journey is, that's what it is. So it's not an easy migration. And also, if we go to chapter 2, verses 3 and 4 of 2 Timothy, it says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. So it compares the Christian with a soldier. It actually says he is a soldier. He is warring. And he doesn't entangle himself. This is a very interesting point I want you to remember. He doesn't entangle himself with the affairs of this life, because it says that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. The butterfly fulfills God's purpose for it in going to its destination year after year, continually. And the Christian, if we are to complete our migration, we will follow him closely and strictly. Now, if we decide that we want to have the conversion experience and go through the metamorphosis, we learnt earlier today it's not such an easy process. It's not all that comfortable. What will happen to us if we enter this, go through this process and become a Christian? Obviously, we become a soldier, we've learnt. And something's going to happen to us. Let's go to 2 Timothy again, 3 verse 12. And it says, "Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." This is a promise, and it's sure. It doesn't give us maybe, it doesn't say some people, it says all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Now, this is a promise on the one hand, and on the other hand, it's not such a nice promise. But we can tell by this whether we're a Christian. If you're being persecuted, if we're being persecuted, we know that Christ is in us and that we are Christians. But if we're not being persecuted, maybe there's something that we are not doing right in our Christian walk. I know in my experience, the closer I have tried to follow God and his will and strive to understand, this was always my fear that Jesus would come and I wouldn't be ready. I was thinking I can join up in the Bible work, I can work for God, I can do all these things, and I can listen to the ministers and study all day, every day, and yet I could still miss out. That doesn't assure me that I'm ready for Jesus when he comes. And this is always something that put fear into me. And so I always strove to study and understand God's will, and not to just study, but to pray and ask God to show me what his will is, and to assure me that that was what he wanted, and that I would have an assurance of my salvation. And the more I got convicted on things, and God did convict me on things, he did answer my prayer, but sometimes I found myself going different than the majority. Sometimes I found myself doing different things than everyone around me, and this created some negative reactions. And more I noticed myself going not out of harmony with everyone. I wasn't just in the crowd and one of them. I was sort of more and more on the outside and saying different things. I'm not saying we have to try to work separate from everyone else. But it just happens that way. Like the Bible says, we will suffer persecution. And sometimes these trials and negative reactions and everything that I'm conscientiously convicted that God wants me to do this, and it's not that I want to do something and go against somebody and everyone. But you have to follow it if God's convicted you. And the trials have made me nearly want to give up my faith because I think, is it really worth it? Is it really worth it to go through all these trials and hard times? But Matthew 10:22, this was one of my favourite chapters at the worst times of my life and the worst trials, Matthew 10 always helps me through, along with other passages as well, but Matthew 10 was a really good one. And in Matthew 10 verse 22, what is the reward for completing our migration? This is the question. Is it really worth it to go through all those trials? It says, "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved." And that's an encouraging promise because Jesus has promised us here that if we endure to the end, we will be saved. And that is worth everything to get to the end and be actually ready. Because I've had other people tell me, you know, these trials, you know, I feel like God has let me down. Things that have led them to become confused and it just seems like the way is not going smooth. But we have promises. And this is why, though, people give up. People end up giving up their faith sometimes because they lose their hold on the promises that God has given and how sure what God says is. Let us go to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 12. And it says, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you." We think when the fiery trials come, we that's all we can see, and we can't see that God is working in this. But here it says, "Think it not strange concerning this." We'll read on further, but I just want to go to another section in the Bible. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7. This is what we should really think of the trials that come our way. 1 Peter 1, verse 7 says, "That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honour and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ." And we know how precious gold is and how much it's worth. And it says here, "The trial of our faith is much more precious than of gold that perisheth." Mm-hmm. And we might ask the question, how is that possible? How could the trial of our faith be more precious than gold that perisheth? I'd like to go to Hebrews chapter 12. Now, we're not going to read the whole chapter, but I'd encourage everyone when they go home to read this chapter, especially if they're finding the way difficult, because Hebrews chapter 12 is a really good chapter in regards to trials that God gives us. We're just going to read a few verses. Verses 5 to 7, and then verse 11. And it says, "And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If ye, if ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? In verse 11, now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. We can be so encouraged with these verses when we are receiving trials, because God is treating us as sons. He is treating us as his own son. And we know that he loves us when he gives us these, even though they don't seem to be that pleasant. They're actually grievous. He does say here they are grievous. So even though they seem hard and horrible, they are actually given to us by God to purify our lives and be ready for Jesus when he comes. Just a little quote from Messages to Young People's page 102. Why do people, so many people, find it too hard and they give up? And they become confused as to what God is doing with them. It says, many of the youth have not a fixed principle to serve God. They sink under every cloud and have no power of endurance. They do not grow in grace. If your steps are ordered by the Lord, dear youth, you must not expect that your path will always be one of outward peace and prosperity. The path that leads to eternal day is not the easiest to travel, and at times it will seem dark and thorny, but you have the assurance that God's everlasting arms encircle you to protect you from evil. He wants you to exercise earnest faith in him and learn to trust him in the shadow as well as in the sunshine. So this is something that we somehow have to cling on during those trials. Sometimes it's even hard to trust these promises. Sometimes we've been over the ground so many times that we think, yes, we've been there, we know the promises, but it's still, where am I? We have an assurance that God's everlasting arms encircle us. And let us read something else. There's some more good news. 1 Peter chapter 4. We go back to where we were before. 1 Peter 4, verses 13 and 14. 1 Peter 4, verses 13 and 14 says, but rejoice inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. So I found that such a wonderful promise, that if we find ourselves in the minority, if we find ourselves not agreeing with everyone, and we are being reproached for Christ's cause, it gives us a promise here that the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon us. Jesus is with us. This is the encouragement. And I wasn't going to read this because I didn't have it in my study, but I was thinking about it earlier. This promise has helped me through so many trials. It's from Desire of Ages, page 483. And it's the most wonderful promise I think I've ever read. It says, through all our trials, we have a never-failing helper. He does not leave us alone to struggle with temptation, to battle with evil, and be finally crushed with burdens and sorrow. Though now he is hidden from mortal sight, the ear of faith can hear his voice saying, fear not, I am with you. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I have endured your sorrows, experienced your struggles, and counted your temptations. I know your tears, I also have wept. The griefs that lie too deep to be breathed into any human ear, I know. Think not that you are desolate and forsaken, though your pain touch no responsive chord in any heart on earth. Look unto me and live. The mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not but depart from thee. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that hath mercy on thee. So I thought that was a really, really wonderful promise that Jesus is alive. He is with us and he knows what we're going through. We think we can't express what we're going through to anyone, but we can express it to Jesus. Even if we think we feel, even if we feel like we are really mad and off the rocker, we can still present it to Jesus because Jesus knows exactly what we're going through. But I think this is the thing that we too often forget, is to remember that Jesus is there, to remember that he is alive, and to remember that he has given us these promises. Let's have a look in Hebrews 12 again. And we're going to read some a very famous verse that I'm sure you all know. But I think it's one that we should continually keep in our mind. Hebrews 12, verses 2 and 3. And this, I believe, will be the key to help us not to ever think about or to actually take action and give up the fight. This verse, or verses, if we look at them and believe them, will keep us on the Christian journey. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. What are we to look at? We are told here to look to Jesus, but what are we to look at specifically? It says, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. So we're told to look to Jesus, to look at what he endured. If we can remember what he endured for us, and he didn't even have to, I believe we will remember that in our trials. So the only way we are ever going to keep focused and get to our heavenly home is by looking to Jesus, the Christian's light. Now, I want to have a look at something else to do with butterflies. How do butterflies stay in the right direction and get where they want to go? Does anybody know this? How do butterflies end up at the right place every year? They fly, yes, that's correct. But how do they know where they're going? They're such little creatures. Well, a butterfly, the navigation for a butterfly, you know, they use the sun. They use light. That is what they use to tell them where they're going. They use it and they keep it on one side of them, and they can know by that position, the position of the sun, where they are going, and they just keep it on that one side of them all the time. And they can get to their destination by this. And there's something interesting to do with this, because butterflies and moths, this is their navigational system. But sometimes they can confuse the sun and think that a light bulb is the sun. And they follow the light bulb and they keep it on one side of them. And that's why a moth, when you might see sometimes a moth flying round and round a light bulb, and it's not getting anywhere, it's just going round and round in circles, because that is what tells it where to go, it thinks. And it does, the real sun does, but there's a false light there. Very deceptive, this light, these light bulbs. And the question is, for the Christian journey, will we mistake a light bulb and will we think that is our sun? That is at where we are to look to. You know, if a moth keeps flying and flying and flying, and it'll eventually die, and especially, and if it follows the light bulb, it will still be in the same spot when it dies as when it started the migration. And it's dead. It hasn't gone anywhere. Now, there's a possibility that we could get confused and follow a light bulb. And you know, we could end up going round and round in circles just like the moth or the butterfly. And we could end up dying in the same position that we started. How do you think, what is some ways do you think we could get mixed up and follow light bulbs instead of the real sun as Christians? Let's go to 1 John chapter 2. We're just going to have a look at a couple of examples here for the Christian, paralleling the butterfly, and see how we could get confused just like the butterfly. We might think, oh, silly moth. But in reality, we might be in just as bad a situation as the moth. 1 John 2, verses 15 to 17. Just a couple of things. We don't have time to look at everything in this, but 15 to 17 says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. This is what Satan can deceive us on. Because we live in the world, we start to be tempted to become like the world. We start to like things in the world that the people are doing around us. Instead of being there for a purpose, we end up being part of them. And it says here that the world will pass away. The love of the world, or the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father. And the world passeth away, but the Father we know will not pass away. Something just a little bit more specific. Let's go to 1 Timothy 6, verses 10 to 12. Because Satan can get us on one thing or the other. If he doesn't get us on one thing in the Christian journey, he will get us on another thing, because all he wants is for us not to make it to the end of the migration. He doesn't care if we are on it, he just doesn't want us to get to the end. And he'll stop us any way he can. 1 Timothy 6, verses 10 to 12. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. Paul reminds us here that to fight the good fight of faith, don't just sit down as civilians and say, we are on the Christian road, we are Christians, we're safe, we've got all the right doctrinal beliefs, we'll get there. Because in the meantime, we have to earn a living. What the tendency is when we have to earn a living is these things become important to us then. Becoming worried about the necessities of life, the house, the car. And I'm not saying these are bad things because, especially if you have a family, you need to look after your family. But the tendency is that we can become so absorbed in this because this is our, you know, we have our full-time job and we become, you know, interested in these things more than our real mission. We could easily forget our real mission. Because Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. We know all these verses, but this is what could happen. And we can end up flying round and round in circles, just like the butterfly, in our little world. And we haven't listened to what Jesus has commanded us to do. How to get to the end of the migration. We've forgot exactly, and we've become deceived in these things, even though we think we are there because we've got the beliefs, and yet we forget about our real work. And Jesus warned us of this very thing, and I believe for a reason. Let's go to Luke chapter 21, verse 34. Luke 21, verse 34. And it says, and take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. The cares of this life can overtake us, and we can become absorbed, and Jesus will come without us knowing. And that's why Jesus gave this warning, take heed. And I believe this is one area we have to be really careful in on the Christian journey. Because what happens, the cares of this life crowd out our whole life, and we don't have time for God. We don't have time to study and pray our personal devotions. This is one area specifically. And what happens is we become lifeless and cold in our Christian profession, because it's not a real thing anymore, and yet we still profess to be Christians. And there's something that we need to learn in this area too, but I just want to read something about butterflies, how they continue their flight through the cold weather, because they get cold just like we do, and they need warmth. It says, butterflies are cold-blooded, meaning they cannot regulate body temperature. As a result, their body temperature changes with the temperature of their surroundings. If they get too cold, they are unable to fly and must warm up their muscles in order to resume flight. Butterflies can fly as long as the air is between 60 and 108 degrees Fahrenheit, although temperatures between 82 and 100 are best. If the temperature drops too low, they may seek a light-coloured rock, sand or leaf in a sunny spot and bask. Butterflies bask with their wings spread out in order to soak up the sun's heat. Now there's another interesting parallel we can learn from the butterfly, because when it gets too cold, it needs the sun to warm it up, because otherwise it cannot fly. It's impossible for that butterfly to keep going when it's too cold. Do you think if we become cold, we might have to stop flying? Do you think we can continue our flight when we're too cold as Christians? We might think we're flying, maybe. And yet we can't really. It's not the case that we are actually flying. I got a statement from Our High Calling, page 175. Our duty, now listen to this, this is really a good statement, this one, because it's a duty, is to live in the atmosphere of Christ's love to breathe his love deeply and to reflect its warmth around us. Now this is our duty, is to reflect Christ's love and warmth around us. Now, do you think we can do this if we don't have Christ in our life? Do you think it's possible to reflect Christ's warmth? If we hold on to certain doctrinal beliefs and tell everyone around us what they have to believe, do you think this is being a faithful Christian and will get us to heaven? No, it says this is our duty, to live in the atmosphere of Christ's love. Because this, I believe, is another important area. We've covered two sections so far, and that is trials will stop us because we'll give up. The cares of this life will stop us because we end up being deceived and get absorbed in them. But there's another area where we get too cold and formal. And what happens is visitors come along, and this is just one little example, and they hold different beliefs to us, and they come from a different background and different denomination, and we like hold off and just stay clear of them. And it's like telling them, look, I'm not going to really be friendly to you until you accept what I believe and come in harmony with me, and then I can come and be friends with you. And Christ, that is exactly the opposite of Christ's way. Because that's exactly how the Jews were. And this is the tendency that we can get ourselves into so easily, is to, because someone believes different, it's all of a sudden this cold silence that it's like, well, I can't really spend that much time with you. I have to be different. Our duty is to reflect Christ's warmth, and that, I'm afraid, is not Christ's warmth. Even though we think we still got the truth and we're getting to heaven. I just want to have a look at that Romans chapter 10, what talks about the Jews' problem. Romans chapter 10. Just have a couple of more verses here. Romans 10 verses 1 to 4. And it says, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth." So, they have a zeal of God, these people, but not according to knowledge. What do you think it's meant by this? It goes on and explains. They're ignorant of God's righteousness. They think they have righteousness. They have a lot of truth. Yet they go about to establish their own righteousness and have not submitted themselves to Christ's righteousness. They don't have the warmth, the humility, the love that Christ had. So this is one area I believe we have to be really careful, because Christ, we have to remember, is the end of the law for righteousness. Christ alone will save us and get us to heaven. And it is not for us to judge someone else because they understand or do something different than we do and believe. From Sons and Daughters of God, page 285 says, "As the light of the sun sheds its warmth throughout all the world, so the bright beams of the Sun of Righteousness will shed health-giving rays into the heart." And I believe this is so important for us, that we need Christ, the Sun of Righteousness, to shed health-giving rays into our heart. Because what happens if we don't have health-giving rays? Obviously, we become sick. and die, and obviously we'll stop flying. And yet the deception is that we still think we're on the migration, we still think we're on the flight. And yet we are sick or even dead, perhaps. I just want to go to John 15. There's only one way we are going to stay balanced in all of this, to keep Christ first in our life, to go through the trials, and to be warm, and warm like Christ was. And this is what we have to remember. John 15, verses 1 to 6. John chapter 15, verses 1 to 6. It says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered, and men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. So this is pretty serious, if we don't abide in Christ. And I believe this is what will keep us on the track and on the right road and on the journey to heaven. There's a little statement here I want to read. In a practical way, how can the bright beams of Christ shine on us? How can Christ abide in us? From The Faith I Live By, page 21. It says, in every command and in every promise of the Word of God is the power, the very life of God, by which the command may be fulfilled and the promise realized. By partaking of this word, our spiritual strength is increased. We grow in grace and in a knowledge of the truth. Habits of self-control are formed and strengthened. The infirmities of childhood, fretfulness, willfulness, selfishness, hasty words, passionate acts disappear, and in their place are developed the graces of Christian manhood and womanhood. And this is what happens when we partake of the Word of God, because we receive the very life of God, the warmth of God. So just quickly recapping, the three main attacks is discouragement that God gives us through, discouragement that Satan brings upon us through the trials that God gives us. See, Satan always works with what God, with God's plan, and always twists it for his advantage. And the other one is sidetracks. He wants to sidetrack us. We get busy in this world and we forget about our purpose and our mission. And the other one is cold and formal religion. And we have a name and we think we live when in reality we're dead. So I pray that we will get to the end of our migration and remember these things. And I'd just like to close with one more verse in Hebrews 11. It's the faith chapter, and it talks about Moses here. How he got to the end of his journey, how he endured to the end. And I think this is really amazing how he did it. After all the instruction we've got, now we have an actual example in history of someone who got to the end and how he got to the end. Hebrews 11, verses 24 to 27. It says, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king. Now listen to this bit. This is my favorite bit in the whole section, it says, "For he endured as seeing him who is invisible." And this is my prayer, that we will focus on Christ and never take our eyes off him. Let us endure as seeing him who is invisible, that we will make it to the end and not end up flying round and round in circles, that we will fulfill God's purpose for us in this world. Amen.